Welcome to the history. Welcome to the culture. Welcome to community that dreams and achieves. Living in change for better tomorrow. Welcome to the Eunice Malat Show.
Welcome to the Eunice Malat Show. I'm your host, Eunice Malat. As South Sudanese residing here in the United States, it is easy to be bombarded by conflicting ideologies, both that are associated with the African perspective as well as the American perspective. And for young kids, it's easy for them to get lost amidst all those bombardment. And especially within the media, you often see South Sudanese kids portrayed in a negative light. But there are positive images that are emerging. The South Sudanese Youth Summit was held in the state of Iowa, which showcased the talent, the brains, and the beauty and handsomeness of South Sudanese youth who are utilizing their brains and their talent to improve our community. I went to Iowa and I filmed the event, and here we go with the event.
My name is Dao Jock. I am a recent college graduate from the University of Pennsylvania, and I'm the founder and director of the Dao Jock Youth Foundation. And this year, we decided to sponsor the South Sudanese Youth Summit 2014, and held here in Iowa. And it's a two-day event with the first day workshops, including tribalism, culture, crime, social media, and bullying. And then the second day, a basketball clinic all day, from 10 to 4, we have young kids out there. We handed them some prizes, school supplies, and other things. And then in the evening, we'll do a gala and sort of celebrate the young people in our community, and we'll have a few speakers. So that's what we're doing. I think it's important because the youth here need to be engaged, because that's the first step. If you engage them, they're more likely to respond.
Good evening. Welcome to the South Sudanese Youth Conference of 2014, Des Moines, Iowa.
I'm Bianca.
And we're going to be orchestrating a workshop regarding crime. So get excited. So the purpose of this, we want to educate individuals on crime, the consequences of crime, and the impact that crime has on not just the individual, but the society and the family and the whole community. And we'll also be having an interactive game at the end. So the more you know now, the more you win in the game. And so throughout the whole workshop, we're going to be following Socratic method. So we'll be asking questions, you know, engaging everybody. So nobody just sit there as if this is a college lecture. So first off, before we begin, does anybody have any questions? Anybody in legal trouble would like legal advice? Free legal advice.
Free legal advice for me. Free to answer
questions. Get a lawyer, don't talk to police.
Alright,
so we're going to begin. First off, I want to ask, what is crime?
At least somebody gotta know what crime is.
When you break the law.
When you break the law, correct. Right. So what happens when you break the law? Is it just breaking the law?
There are consequences.
Yes.
There are consequences, correct. So can we define crime as breaking the law?
Breaking these laws.
Crime is breaking a set of laws in a certain jurisdiction. So, in United States jurisprudence system, they have two sets of jurisdictions. And jurisdictions are areas. So the state of South Dakota, the state of Missouri, the state of Iowa, they have their own jurisdictions. And the United States government has jurisdictions all over the United States. Makes sense. So jurisdictions. So if you commit a crime in Iowa that is against Iowa laws, you're violating the laws of Iowa when you commit a crime in Iowa. But if you commit crimes against the federal government, these crimes are kidnapping, bank robbery, domestic terrorism, anybody know any others?
Murder. Rape?
No, murder is a state crime. State. Rape is a state crime.
You learned something every day.
So if you commit a crime, you'll be persecuted in the state court system. And the court system is fine.
Yes.
So you have the Supreme Court. You have the Court of Appeals, and then you have the District Courts. Does anybody want to help us and lead the way if they know?
Supreme Court is the highest court.
The Supreme Court is the highest court. The state Supreme Court is the highest court in the state. What is the Court of Appeals?
When you're appealed.
When you appeal. Makes sense. And what is the district court? Court is the district, huh? Well, the district court in most states is a county. So we're in Polk County. So if you commit a crime, you'll be persecuted by the Polk County attorney's office. If you don't like what you happen to, you can appeal. Most of the time, you won't be granted in criminal cases, but you can go to a court of appeals. And the Court of Appeals, they say you don't like it there. You can go to the Supreme Court, and they decide. But after there, no more chances.
Yep.
So third time's a charm for some people. And there's two steps. There's criminal law and civil law. So let's start Branson. What's an example? What's a criminal offense? These are also called tort laws.
That is law.
No, that would be criminal law. That's a minor infraction.
When you get on your name in public,
that'd be
civil.
In some cases, somebody may sue you for that.
So, you're talking about someone taking money, so you're talking about like the basic my property, and then them taking.
If you say bad stuff on the internet and I don't like it, I can take you to court for defamation or slander, meaning that I can say that this individual disrespected me and used my name in a bad way, and I take it to civil court. Civil court, you have a plaintiff and a defendant. Criminal, you have the prosecution, which is the state. The state is always going to be the one that's against you in criminal. So criminal offenses are any sort of offenses where you're arrested by the police. Robbery, murder, burglary, assault, domestic abuse. The state says that you violate our law, so we're going to take care of you, and we're going to punish me to see what's fit. And this is where you go to sentencing. So, in different jurisdictions, they have rules regarding sentences. What's a sentence?
Time in jail.
Time in jail, or punishment. The United States, unlike other countries, does not believe in restorative justice. So the United States likes to send people away for a lot, for minor crimes. And the United States prisons are privately owned, a lot of them privately owned. So the lobbyists try to get Congress to pass laws, therefore sentences are increased so they have more prisoners in the bed staying longer. That's for another story. But punishment ranges. There's three. There's a felony and a misdemeanor. What's an example of a felony?
Robbery.
Burglary. Identity theft. First degree theft. And there's four. Class A, B, C, D. Class A felonies, if you commit Class A felony, you'll face 10 years to life. Class B felonies are 5 years to 25. Class C are usually up to 5 years, if not probation. And Class D is usually just probation. So everything ranges. So now we're going to go into the good stuff. What do you need to know? So if you're arrested right now and charged with a crime, what would you do? So we're going to demonstrate. Yeah? I'm going to arrest you.
Get a lawyer.
The police. Following the United States ruling of Miranda Lessons, the United States Supreme Court in 1960 passed something known as Miranda versus Arizona, meaning that the police must inform you of your constitutional rights. That's why when you're arrested, they say you have the right to remain silent. That's your Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination. You have a right to an attorney. That's Sixth Amendment right against counsel. And anything you say or you do can be used against you in a court of law. The United States, in criminal court, you do not have to take the stand. If I'm being charged with a crime, I don't have to take the stand, and the prosecutor don't have to question me. That is, I plead the Fifth, meaning that I'm not going to say anything, because if I say something, it's going to incriminate me. So if I committed a crime, and they put me in a witness stand, they say, did you do it? I can say, I plead the Fifth. People are going to know I probably did it, because I don't want to say anything, or risk perjury, but you plead the Fifth. So, if you're ever arrested by the police officers and you're facing a crime, the police officer will first take you to station. They'll question you, you know, what happened. Afterwards, they'll decide if they're going to arraign you or not. An arraignment is, we're going to read you your charges. You're facing 2 counts of first-degree murder, 3 counts of robbery. Mm-hmm. So, that's the arraignment. And for each of these offenses, you'll know how much you're going to face. So, if you were to be arrested, the first thing you must ask, you do not go to question. You have a right not to go to question. You have a right to an attorney. If you're arrested, you say, officer, may I speak to my attorney? The officers are going to want to coerce you to confess, so the trick is to sign the Miranda warnings. But you sign them and you ask for your attorney, because the police officers may not question you after you ask for attorney. If they do, the evidence will be thrown out at trial, violating the constitutional rights. In the United States, there's 3 amendments that deal with criminal law. That's the Fourth Amendment regarding legal search and seizure. That is, if the police come to my house without a warrant and get evidence, let's say a gun that I used to rob a store, they can't present the evidence against me at trial because it's obtained illegally. The police must go to the magistrate, obtain a search warrant, say, we have probable cause or reasonable suspicion to stop this person. If I'm driving, following the speed limit, and the cop stops me, do they have a right to do so? For no reason. What if the cops say, I just feel like stopping you? Not probable cause. You have to have reasonable suspicion. So, if I'm a cop and you're going 5 over and I stop you and I search your car, is that reasonable suspicion to pull you over?
5 over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because you're breaking the law. Even if you're going 1 over, you're breaking the law. So, the Fourth Amendment deals with searches. It's just evidence. And then the Fifth Amendment is just plain. It's self-incrimination. And this deals with more of your, in a sense, if the cop stops you and asks for your license, you may deny them because you say, I'm going to plead the Fifth, because if I give you my license, I'm violating my Fifth Amendment rights. Most likely, they'll find something on you, but that's not the smart thing. But you can do in some states. In Iowa, I think you can do that. So don't take my word for it. But if you do get arrested, you know what to do, so you're in good shape. Okay, who knows what the Sixth Amendment is? To the government? Huh? What? What? What else is the Sixth Amendment? Sixth Amendment. Right to bear arms is the Sixth Amendment. Sixth Amendment deals with right to counsel.
Right to what?
So, right to counsel. Counsel is attorney. In 1967, in Gideon versus Wainwright, the United States made a ruling that any individual, regardless of how poor, they have a right to counsel. And this ruling overturned Best versus Brady. In Best versus Brady, the court ruled that if you can't afford a lawyer, you may not get one. But in Gideon, they overturned this. So no matter what you do, you have a right to an attorney. That is in criminal cases. If you are suing me, you can't request an attorney because that's a civil case. But if the federal government or the state government is trying to press charges on you, you have a right to an attorney. And you'll get a public defender. They're not the best attorney, but they're better than anybody. Or you may even defend yourself pro se. And pro se is a term that they use in the legal world, which means you're defending yourself and you have no attorney. But the right to counsel attaches as soon as you're arrested, meaning that once you're arrested and the police want to take you for questioning, you may say, officer, I want my attorney and I'm not going to speak to you. And they cannot further question you. And if they do, if they beat you, they can't do that. They can't force you to say something. That's where they cross the line. So the first thing you do, so if you're arrested, what's the first thing you're gonna do? All right. I need a volunteer. Joseph, come here. Oh, no. Manuel, come here. Back for, come here.
Last one.
So we're going to demonstrate just basic police. So I'm going to say, we're suspecting you for a new sir. So put your hands. You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say or do can be used against you in a court of law. You have a right to an attorney. If you do not have one, the court provides you one. So what are you going to do?
I need a lawyer.
We're going to go for questioning first, sir. You can't get a lawyer. Now, that's the way. The police, they will not give you a lawyer. Right there, they violated the Constitution. And the federal government, people don't realize this, but the federal government comes really hard on police when they do stuff that they're not supposed to do. Police brutality, illegal evidence, you know, going using, they're really popular in drug offenses. Because the police, if I'm walking by that police officer and I see loud music coming from your house, is that reasonable suspicion?
Loud music? It's disturbing the peace.
No, but if I, as an officer, if I am patrolling looking for drugs and I hear loud music coming from Cashwell's house.
So it's not reasonable suspicion.
What if, you know, we have reason to believe that he's in a big drug ring. He has yayo, meth, you know, marijuana, all that stuff. Like Breaking Bad. So, is that probable cause?
Tell me.
If the police come into your house without a warrant and no reason suspicion, let's say they're coming knocking on the door, say hi, we're in the neighborhood, and they see that there's a gun there, and that gun has been registered, that gun was used to murder somebody, they can't use that against you in trial. They need a warrant. There's many exceptions more down the rules, but sort of we're gonna gear towards restorative justice. And restorative justice system is this: if somebody commits a crime, they didn't just commit a crime; they commit a crime against the community. And it's the community's job to, when they're released, bring them back into the community and help them and better themselves. We can't say this person's locked up, we're gonna look at it differently. No, when they're locked up, they're at their down point. You need to be there for them, whether it be friend, brother, sister, cousin, whatever, you have to support them emotionally and mentally and understand, like, you know, you may have done something wrong, but I'm going to support you because I don't want this happening to you or somebody else. And that is why a community-based system, you know, we have a lot of our Sudanese brothers that are in American prisons. You know, it hurts, but we can't sit there and judge them. We have to do our best. When they come out, it is our job to make sure that they don't do something again. If they need a place to stay, if they need some money, if they need a job, if you can provide it, do it. Because at the end of the day, who are you to judge them because they committed a crime? You don't even know if they were guilty or not. Who are you to say, oh, this guy did time? No, you don't know. You just know that they were tried and found guilty. That's all it is. So with that is take the identity of, you know, don't get wrapped up in being something you're not. You know, I know it sounds so cliche, but at the end of the day, it's just be who you are. And do your best to help people. You know, for me, at the end of the day, whether South Sudan falls or not, we're still going to be part of it.
Right.
Whether you're being good, whatever. If it falls, we're all South Sudanese. If it succeeds, we're all South Sudanese. So why not help another South Sudanese brother or sister? Because whether he may be Nuer, it may be Danko, so be it. You know, one of my best friends, not even in my tribe. It doesn't even matter. Because we, as South Sudanese, you know, I know it sounds, we have to stick here. Our identity as people. So I take with you, you know, take this identity thing. Be who you are. Don't do something that you wouldn't want to do. And if you see somebody in a time of need, especially with the legal system, you can't vote, you can't apply for housing, there's a lot of things you can't do. You have to help them. You can't just say, this guy did time or he's a bad person. No, you're a bad person for thinking you're better than them just because something happened to them. You may have known, maybe they went through redemption when they're locked up. It happens a lot. But you are the person. So I just want to say thank you.
One of the fears out of the hat and then say it all out and then talk about why you think somebody would feel that way.
Right, interpreting the message. or giving suggestions?
Yeah.
Anything you really want to do. We're just trying to elaborate on what they might have been thinking or saying. Don't forget this. You have to read it aloud.
Listen, please. Right. Yeah.
So
glad. I fear not being successful. And I think that's very, very important. You know, everybody, I think, you know, everybody sitting in here, we all have a purpose, you know, being successful, waking up, being somebody someday, and And like me personally, success is the goal. You know, success is what I, you know, what I live for and what I go after every single day. Because if you're not successful, and first of all, you know, education comes first, man. If you don't have the education, you may not be successful. And some success comes without education. You might have a wealthy family members and, or you know, a father that is a businessman that has lots of money, and you can, you know, take over his business and be a successful person. But I think us coming from a third world country, we literally have to like seriously, it's a mandatory. Education is a mandatory for me, and I have an obligation to be successful. So, you know, saying that I think fear of not being successful, I think it's a good fear, and I think everybody here should have to keep that in mind. So.
Oh, drowning. I guess the best way to get over this fear is maybe learn to swim. I guess it takes time to see why you're scared and try to face that fear.
What are you scared of?
I'm afraid, like little fear.
Anything. And why?
Personally, I'm afraid of like disappointing others. Like I always want to make people proud, like my brother, my family. So it's like disappointing others is one of my biggest fears, and I just want to always improve myself by doing the best I can. Yeah.
Why'd she pick you off?
We already did this one.
On the shopping. Maybe there's a couple.
Then again, it could be
a couple.
Oh, yeah, it could be a good
question. Ooh, it's a good one. God.
Yes.
Oh, it should all be.
That's a good one because personally, I fear God, and that's if you don't believe in God, then you're entitled to your own opinion. But that's a good fear because it's the reason why we're here. And like, you're supposed to fear.
Can I add to something?
Yeah.
I mean, I think we should all fear God because, you know, he's the ultimate creator, and we should fear and believe in him because he pretty much paved the way for us. And if you don't fear God, then who else should you fear? Because he's the only guy. And I mean, not everybody here is a firm believer, but I mean, if you're a believer, then you should fear God. You know, everything, you know, above earth or on earth, you know, God is in control of everything. So yeah, we should fear him and believe in him and trust in him, you know, and just kind of thank him for everything that we do, you know. Yeah. Wake up every single day, hey, God, thank you for waking me up, and hey, I'm going to go out and have an amazing day because of you.
Right.
So.
Thank you.
Oh,
Well, I won't be able to finish school being right here. And that honestly comes with the fear of, well, this person that wrote this is dealing with mockery. It's a spirit that really tells someone, oh, that you're not gonna do this, you're not gonna be successful, you're nothing, you're just gonna be a failure in life. And that's something that you have to really fight. And really, the way to fight that is letting God into your life. Because with him, you have to trade your worries in for faith. Whenever you give God all your worries, everything that you're dealing with, no matter how hard it is, he will listen to you. Like he'll literally listen to you, and all you have to do is have faith and believe that he'll take care of that. So.
That
activity was
just
kind of to,
you know,
interact with
each
other.
There's more stuff we need
to discuss.
Stand up. Go ahead,
stand up. Well,
yeah.
You can just say you'll fear them.
Just stand up, please.
I have three down there.
stand up, please. Just stand up.
Introduce yourself, please.
First of all, my name is Kiriende, and I'm from Kansas. And I put three people down there. One is going to prison in this country, one is child support.
Child support?
Sudanese waiting.
What was the last Sudanese lady?
Is there a reason why in particular you hear those things?
Not really.
Thanks for sharing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Because a lot of people, I'm sure there's a lot of them in there, I wish we would have done a little bit more to kind of see the similarities of what fears and worries that we have. So I feel like we have a lot of the same things. So,
Hi, my name is Aoyen Kwanagoth, and today I did a presentation about social media and bullying and how it connects in terms of within the Sudanese community. And pretty much the topic was a big issue for especially the Sudanese youth. So it was very important that we covered that, and I had a lot of fun, and I think that all the projects and presentations that were presented were wonderful, and they went right as planned, if not better. And I had a lot of fun meeting new people and getting to know and interact with other people that I haven't even met before. So I had a great time, and I hope to come again soon and have another youth conference.
I hope that in the course of the 26 minutes or so, you're able to gain a wealth of information, and you're also fascinated and inspired by what the young South Sudanese youth had to say and the images that they were portraying, which were very positive. Next week, we're going to go and air the second portion of the South Sudanese Youth Summit. We hope that you'll join us then. Thank you for watching the program.
If you believe, you can achieve. Welcome to the culture. Welcome to community.